How do we source the plant material for actual use in the nursery? And that depends on the plant and how it grows. So I would say 60 to 70%, maybe even higher.
Yeah, might be as high as 80% is seed grown.
Seed grown, yeah. And then
there's a reason for that.
Yeah, genetic diversity.
Genetic diversity.
We're aiming to not create clones of a lot of these things necessarily. You know, unless we find something that's specifically super attractive or useful. We want the diversity within the plants to come out.
So you will get color variation in the flowers, you might get color variation in the foliage.
Yeah.
Or even in the bracts. Yeah. Now, not just this plant specifically, I'm just using it because it happens to be right behind me. Like, you see this one has a purple, and this one does not. That's what happens when with seed variability. And sometimes you get something really strikingly different that way.
Yeah.
Perhaps even a better berry.
Yeah. Or ornamental. Or you get a plant with a bigger root. You know, there's any kind of a number of things that could happen. In which case, then you might want to take cuttings or root divisions, which probably accounts for another 10-15% of the nursery production.
And that would be clonal production. Yeah. But we also do clonal production, whereas we take as many cuttings from as many different plants as possible to mimic diversity, to get a diverse selection. And that, like, woodland phlox would be a classic example because it's very variable in color. You'll have white ones, blue ones, pink ones, in various shades, and so we take cuttings from all those different forms, and we end up with something that looks like it was produced by seed.
Yeah, and seed collection on some of those woodland plants can be difficult. The seed production is limited. Germination is erratic. And so it's actually just easier to produce them via cuttings.
And then there's division.
Yeah, and division's done usually for the similar reason.
Like, this is a classic division plant because it tends to be somewhat stoloniferous and spreading, so you could chop one of these and get like 4, 5, 6 plants out of one pot.
Yeah.
But these are seed grown.
This plant was planted from seed, grown from seed, and within the genome or within the genetic makeup of this plant, there are color forms for it, white or pink, and sometimes you can get even really very pink ones. And you also get foliage differences too. Some of them, the foliage is very blue and some of it's more of a green. So there's a lot of variation within plants, and some of them are even, you know, this is usually two-tone, it's either white or pink. You can get some plants that have a much stronger variation within the plant in terms of flower color, but you also get different height variations sometimes. You can get tolerances to drought in some cases. There's all kinds of genetic potential locked up in all plants.
You know
plants.
One of the main ones is? No. This is what I've noticed. One of the main genetic variations is flower time.
Yeah.
Within even a single population of a species, you will notice that they bloom. There will be earlier blooming ones and later blooming ones. That is the strategy to handle changing environmental factors that might prevent the earlier bloomers from setting seed, or vice versa, the later bloomers from setting seed. In other words, they're covering all their bets.
Fire pink's a good example of that, actually, now that I think about it, because fire pink is a little red flower. It blooms in May, some populations, but then there are some populations that bloom in June, and there are some populations that bloom in July. All right, this is Allegheny Pachysandra. That's the native Pachysandra. There is actually an American one. And while Asian Pachysandra is usually produced through root division because it's a fast spreader, this tends to form a clump. So you can't really do you can do root division on it, but the results are minimal. So you can do cuttings on these. And so basically I've severed this from the parent plant. I've removed almost all the leaves. On some plants I'll remove even more, and basically just cutting them off. And then setting them in a sterile medium of peat and perlite under mist This will come on periodically to keep the leaves moist. And in some cases, I've not only removed the leaves, I've cut the remaining leaves in half. And the whole idea is to reduce the evaporation of, or the expiration of the plant from water loss through the leaves. So anyway, we produce a number of plants this way.